Good morning, everybody. Welcome here this morning. It's good to be here. Oh, it feels great outside. It feels like spring is actually maybe kind of here. And just good to be gathered together. Welcome to those who are visiting with us today or first time here. I know there's a few of you. So if you see someone who looks strange, including some of the regulars look strange, then be sure and say hello to them this morning. All right. You know what? No, we can't. We've got, there is a little bit of COVID going around, so I'd like to shake hands with each other, but we'll wait just a little bit yet. Why don't you stand up and wave to some people around you? Let's do that. Yeah, wave to some people around you. A couple of announcements just before Sandra comes to pray. You know that Easter's coming up, right? And we have a Good Friday service. It'll be in the community hall on Good Friday at 10:30. It's a community-wide service, so we invite you to come there and join us for that. And then as well, actually, let me rewind it. Next Sunday is actually Palm Sunday, and so we're having a brunch, and that's like right after the service, right? Okay, so every week now, you get to come downstairs and have coffee and goodies. So please stay after the service today if you want. There's coffee and goodies downstairs. But next week will be something special. It's going to be a brunch. So Pat is cooking up a storm, even more than normal. And so you'll want to join us next week afterwards. It'll be a great time together. And then the following week being Easter, we'll have the Easter Sunday service here as well, regular time, 10:30. I do want to let you know that tonight at 6 o'clock is a hymn sing. And Pastor Rick is going to be leading, and Glenda is playing, and I've invited some people, and I know some of you invited people from the community to come out and sing. So please join us if you're able to, 6 o'clock tonight. And the format is basically any hymn that's in the hymn book that we'll say, we'll try. You may have to do a solo if no one knows it. But anything that's in the hymn book, you can ask for it, and we'll sing for about an hour, and then there will be some goodies downstairs and so on. Last time that we did this, and we're trying to do it the first Sunday of the month, and last time we did it, Marlene broke into some hash chorus thing. That wasn't even in the hymn book, but you never know what's going to happen. So please join us tonight at 6 o'clock for that.
Come to the well that never Okay. I'm going to ask any of the kids that are planning to go downstairs, stand up. Okay. Today, Mr. and Mrs. Sammy are helping out. They are teaching your class. So I have to pray for you, okay? I'm not sure what's going to happen down there. Let's pray. Dear Lord, be with these kids and be with Steve and Shelley. Help them to have a great time together and just guide them in this time. Thank you for these children, Lord. Bless them. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, you can go downstairs.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood.
Let's try that again. Let's do this in C, right? All right. Let's and you got to stand up with us. All right.
That was just a practice.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight. Visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled in his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
I love to tell the story of amazing things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell story, because I know it is true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old story and his love. I love to tell the story, more wonderful it seems than all the golden fancies of all our golden dreams. I love to tell the story, it did so much for me, and that is just the reason I tell them now to thee. I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme in glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story, tis pleasant to repeat. When seems each time I tell it, more wonderfully sweet. I love to tell the story, for some have never heard the message of salvation from God's own holy word. I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme in glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story, for those who know it best seem hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest. And when it sings of glory, I sing the new song. 'Twill be the old, old story that I have loved so long.
Let's do this a cappella.
I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme in glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love.
Please be seated. All right. This mic is on enough you can hear me. Thanks, Andy and Tracy. If you have your Bibles, you can turn, or you can follow along in the notes in the bulletin. John chapter 3 is where we are this morning. Last week, I was watching online as my brother was here speaking. Some have said that he looks like me. I always consider myself better looking than that, but anyway, he's actually just a little over 10 months older than me. I think I maybe told you that some of you this before, but and we grew up pretty close. And then I got another brother who's just over a year younger than me. And so when my mom, third child, the nurses asked her how many children, she said, well, this is my third, and what are their ages? She says, well, they're all one and under. And because my oldest brother, Doug, who was here last week, hadn't yet turned two. He was about to turn two. So as the story goes, the nurses kicked my dad out of the hospital and said, stay away from her. All right. If you had to put your life into a song, something that would summarize or be, you know, sort of your life song, what might it be? There's lots of people have tried to do that. And there's this song that goes along with this passage in John 3:16. If you Google it now, if you Google John 3:16, you're more likely to come up with a song from Keith Urban than you are for it to take you to the Bible text right now, because he wrote a song called John Cougar, John Deere, and John 3:16. He says, I'm a 45 spinning on an old Victrola. I'm a two-strike swinger. I'm a Pepsi Cola. I'm a blue jean quarterback saying I love you to the prom queen in a Chevy. I'm John Wayne, Superman, California. I'm Kris Kristofferson on Sunday morning. Some of you can, you know some of the songs that go with some of these. Kris Kristofferson, Sunday morning coming down. Johnny Cash saying that. I'm a mom and daddy singing along to Don McLean at the levee. And I'm a child of backseat freedom, baptized by rock and roll, Marilyn Monroe in the Garden of Eden. Never grow up, never grow old, just another rebel in the great wide open on the boulevard of broken dreams. And I learned everything I need to know from John Cougar, John Deere, and John 3:16. I'm Mark Twain on the Mississippi. I'm Hemingway with a shot of whiskey. I'm a TV dinner on a tray trying to figure out the Wheel of Fortune. I'm a Texaco star. I'm a Gibson guitar. I'm still a teenage kid trying to go too far. I'm a jukebox waiting in a neon bar for a quarter. And everything I needed to know, I learned from John Cougar, John Deere, and John 3:16. And while it's an interesting song, and there's some good parts to it, I like the tune, and it's easy to get caught up in the song. If you were to put a song for your life, what might that song look like? What would be a summary of what you stand for, of maybe the things that are most important in your life? And for this guy, for Keith Urban, I mean, it was John 3:16, a lot of other things along with it, but I'm glad John 3:16 was there. But this passage has been so formative to so many people. It's one of those things that we see plastered on billboards and, like I say, at football games and that sort of stuff. But a lot of people don't really understand or know much about where it comes from. And maybe you do, but it's this passage in John chapter 3. And this passage starts off in John chapter 3. As we're introduced to it, it says, now there is a man of the Pharisees. So here's this guy's song, this guy that we're about to meet here. There's this man, and if he had a song that was his song, it'd be something about he was a Pharisee. He was a man of the Pharisees. That's what he was known for. He was this guy who was part of this religious group. It was what he grew up knowing. The Pharisees were some of the religious leaders at the time of Jesus. The religious leaders at that time, they included chief priests. And if you read your Bible, you'll see different times it refers to some of these religious leaders, chief priests and elders and Pharisees and Sadducees and so on, just different ones. The Pharisees were these holy men who kept the law. They pursued purity with a passion, and they wanted nothing more than to live lives that pleased God. But they, while sincere, and many times were pretty misguided in some of the priorities they kept, there were about 6,000 Pharisees in the country. Actually, some suggest no more than 6,000. They were part of a group called the Chabura, or known as the Brotherhood of Pharisees. They entered into this brotherhood by taking a pledge in front of three witnesses, and that they would spend all of their lives observing every detail of the scribal law of that day. And that was really the problem, because they had these things that were written. The scribes had created the Mishnah, the writings that codified this scribal law, and then there was the Talmud on top of it, which is a commentary on the Mishnah. And in on top of all of that, or at the basis of all of it, was the Old Testament, which we know now, including Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, the Pentateuch, and the writings of the law and the prophets, and in the Old Testament as we know it. But they had all of these things on top of it to help guide them, so that not only would they be able to keep the law, but they would keep themselves from even getting close to not keeping the law, and so they created all sorts of other rules. They especially had rules around Sabbath. Don't work, don't bear other burdens, the Bible says, but rest and keep it holy. And they thought, well, work had to be defined. If you're not supposed to work, what does it mean to carry burdens? That had to be defined. And so they had all sorts of rules. Get milk enough just for one swallow. That's anything more than one swallow of milk is more work than you should do on the Sabbath. Carry a spoon weighing no more than one fig. If you carried a spoon weighing more than one fig, that was work. To this day, some Orthodox Jews carry out the rules of the Sabbath as outlined in the Mishnah and the Talmud and apply them to our current situation, so that in some places in Israel, especially where there's Orthodox Jews, on the Sabbath, which is Saturday, they will, if you take an elevator, they have every button pushed. So if you're going out a big building, you have to stop at every floor because it's too much work to push the elevator all the way up. I mean, that's the way it translates for us into the world now. But here's this guy who grew up in this system, and his life was defined around that. Here was this guy who was a Pharisee. He was a man of the Pharisees. He was one of 6,000 people. So it wasn't like there were a whole bunch of people. There was a pretty prestigious position to hold. But it doesn't end there, because we find out that after it gives us his name of Nicodemus, it tells us that he was a member of the ruling council. And this ruling council, probably referring to a Sanhedrin, which was a Jewish council of 71 or 70 members. Some discussion over what is there an extra member there, but they were patterned after the 70 elders that God established through Moses way back in the earliest parts of the Old Testament, in the Council of Elders. And they were under Roman authority, and they could do, rule over the people, but they weren't allowed to carry out capital punishment. And so that's why when it came to Jesus' crucifixion, they had to appeal to Pilate to be able to crucify, because they were not allowed to carry out capital punishment. Jerusalem was destroyed in AD 70, and at that point, the Sanhedrin ceased to exist. There is a move today to try and restore the Sanhedrin to ruling in Israel. But he was part not only of the Pharisees that would define his life, but to be a Pharisee, you had to really know your Bible and all of the other rules and writings that came on top of it, because people would not only look to you to follow your pattern of life, but people would expect you to give them answers to be able to teach them about these things. And on top of that, he was part of the Sanhedrin, which was an elite ruling group. And Jesus later on in this tells us that he's a teacher in Israel, which may suggest that he was perhaps one of the most prominent people in the land when it comes to knowing the Bible and teaching. He was really looked to. He was one that people really esteemed highly. But we get another hint here, that his name is a Greek name, Nicodemus. Nicodemus is a Greek name. Now, you had to be Jewish to be part of the Pharisees. So we know that he's Jewish, but he's given a Greek name, which means probably that he was upper class. It meant that probably he was schooled in the various Greek philosophers. Not only was he schooled in Jewish things to the nth degree, but he probably went to some school and learned some of the writings of Socrates and Philo and Aristotle. He was schooled in Greek, probably. And he was looked to, if Mama looked down on Nicodemus, he was this model child, and this was sort of his life from the onset, and he was living fully into it, and he was this guy who was, a ruler in the land, and he was probably this Greek schooled as well. He's just a really well-rounded academic guy who was very prominent in the people. As a matter of fact, I think Mom decided at an early age that she was going to name him into that role, and so she gave him the name Nicodemus, which means ruler of the people. So here's Nicodemus. We find out in this passage there was this man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, and he was a member of the Jewish ruling council. So here's his life. Here's his story. Here's his song. He's this elite leader. Now, you might not be a guy like Nicodemus. It might be that your life's a little bit different. maybe you are like the, you know, part of the song about 45 spinning an old Victrola, maybe your Pepsi Cola, maybe you're a little bit more grassroots. Maybe you're like Chris Christopherson and Sunday morning coming down. I woke up Sunday morning with no way to hold my head that didn't hurt, and the beer I had for breakfast wasn't bad, so I had one more for dessert. And I fumbled through my closet for my clothes, and I found my cleanest dirty shirt. Maybe you're the person like in this song where he talks about I'm John Cougar, and John Cougar is small town. I played that song for you a while back for some of you who are here. Maybe you're that kind of person. Maybe your song is, you're a small town person. Maybe your song is John Cougar had a song called Jack and Diane, two kids, American kids growing up in the heartland. Maybe you're just this rural kind of person. I don't know what your song is. I don't know what you are like, but here's this guy, Nicodemus, and he knew what he was about. But there was a problem, because although he had all the answers in the Bible, although he knew all of, you know, so these great mysteries of how to interpret the scriptures, and although he probably was schooled in Greek philosophy, one thing burned on his heart and on his mind, and it just didn't jive with what he understood, and that was, how could this person who was from, you know, the sticks, Jesus, who was from Nazareth, and as they say, nothing good can come out of Nazareth. I mean, he's just a carpenter's kid. This is a redneck from the north. How can this Jesus, as they call him, and have no background, not be a Pharisee? He's not one of the rulers. He's not a scribe. He's none of those things. How can he be coming around and doing these things and performing all sorts of miracles? Like, something doesn't jive. Like, you don't expect God to be working through this redneck from the north. How does this work? But because he was from this, you know, this establishment, and he was from, you know, the uppity ups of the world at that time, he couldn't just ask him that. Now, he knew Jesus enough, because he followed around. He knew enough to see that he was performing these miracles. He was probably there for some of the times when they questioned him and tried to stump Jesus. You know, here's this woman, she's been married 7 times in heaven. When you get to heaven, whose wife is she going to be? Husband 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, or the one she's now, you know, trying to stump Jesus. So he was there as they kept the Pharisees trying to stump Jesus. He knew some of those things, no doubt. And in fact, we know that for sure, as he saw Jesus do enough of these miraculous signs, that something was burning in his heart and didn't sit right, because for all of the ideas of who Jesus was, how could it be that God would work through this person? So he comes to Jesus and he says, Rabbi, which is a big statement to say. He says, Rabbi, we know you are a teacher who's come from God. He something is burning in his heart. He's got a question, or he's got a statement to say about Jesus. And it doesn't sit right. Doesn't make sense. But how do you talk to him? So what does he do? He doesn't come to him in broad daylight. Too much reputation on the line there. Comes him at nighttime, quietly, checking the doors. No one's seeing him asking this question. So he comes in to ask the question, or to make a statement. And he can't really put it on his lips in the form of a question, because he's a teacher. He's one schooled in law, and he's used to just making pronouncements or answering questions. So he comes to Jesus with a statement, but behind that statement is a question, and Jesus knows that. And his statement is that we know that you're a teacher that's come from God. No one can perform the miraculous signs you're doing if God's not with him. He's a philosopher. He's a theologian. He's a deep thinker. He's looking at Jesus, and he wants to put Jesus in a box and say, this is who Jesus is, and I'm comfortable, and I can carry on with my business. But it doesn't sit right, because how can this Jesus be doing this? And the claims that Jesus is making, how can he make those claims? If he's a good person, you can't make the kind of claims that Jesus made. A little bit later on, he would claim to be God. He would claim to be the I Am, That is the name of Jehovah God in the Old Testament that even scholars, even Nicodemus, wouldn't utter from his lips because it was too holy. Jesus said, before Abraham was, I am Jehovah. Because of that, we find out in John chapter 8, they picked up stones to stone Jesus to kill him. He made a bold claim to be God. John chapter 8, you can read that. There's lots of other places. But this question, no doubt, tormented Nicodemus, and it's the same question that tormented a guy by the name of C.S. Lewis a number of years ago. He's a British writer, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. He was friends with J.R.R. Tolkien. When I was in London at one point, wanted to go to the little pub that Tolkien and C.S. Lewis would meet at, and they would, the Inklings, and they would meet and talk about philosophy. But here was this guy, C.S. Lewis, and he had the same problem with Jesus. And he put it in this way. He said, I'm trying here to prevent anyone saying the really foolish thing that people often say about him, that is Christ. Here's the foolish thing. I'm ready to accept Jesus as a great moral teacher, but I don't accept his claim to be God. That is the one thing we must not say. A man who was merely a man and said the sort of things Jesus said would not be a great moral teacher. He would either be a lunatic on the level with the man who says he's a poached egg, or else he would be the devil of hell. You must make your choice. Either this man was and is the Son of God, or else a madman, or something worse. You can shut him up for a fool, you can spit at him and kill him as a demon, or you can fall at his feet and call him Lord and God. But let us not come up with any patronizing nonsense about his being a great human teacher. He has not left that open to us. He did not intend to. That's C.S. Lewis, thousands of years later, coming up with the same problem that Nicodemus is facing here. He says, you know, how can these things be? He comes to Jesus and says, how does this happen? He's making a statement, you know, no one can do these things unless they're sent of God. And Jesus makes another statement in response to him. He says, I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again. Unless he's born again. Now, if you were Nicodemus, you were probably anticipating a good theological discussion with this Jesus over this. Let's talk about end times. Let's talk about, you know, what happens after death. Because the Pharisees believed in the resurrection. The Sadducees didn't, and it was a popular debate in that day, what happened after death. Well, let's talk about something like that. Or let's talk about divorce. So let's talk about some of those trick questions. No. And that was the comfort zone for someone like Nicodemus. He could quote, many of them could quote the entire Old Testament. For sure, many Jewish boys had to learn the first five books of the Old Testament, the Pentateuch, to be able to recite it by the time they were 13 years of age. Someone who was a Pharisee and a teacher of the law knew far more than that. And he expected a question or some discussion, I think, like that. But Jesus says something that is completely out of the blue. Ever had a discussion with someone and they say something and you think that you're ready for the argument, for the discussion? Maybe it's about politics. Maybe it's about science. Maybe you've had some of those discussions in the midst of COVID and you think you got an answer for them, but they say something that is so out of the blue that it really stumps you. That's kind of what's going on here with Jesus. He says something that he's not ready for. Jesus says, I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again. Born again? I expect something about resurrection, something about, you know, theology. What are you talking about? Born again? What do you expect me to go back into my mother's womb and be born again? Like, he's not ready for this discussion. He's not ready for that answer. And in fact, that's the reply he gives. Is that surely he cannot enter a second time into a mother's womb to be born again. Jesus says, I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he's born of water and of the Spirit. Now, there's a lot of debate about what is meant by born of the water. Some suggest that it's baptism. I don't think. Because I think that contradicts too much of the rest of Scripture. Some suggest it's the Word of God, and 1 Peter talks about the Word of God being like water, being born of the Word. But really, in this passage, it seems to make so much sense that there's two births. There's the natural birth, born of the water, born of flesh, because Jesus says in the next verse, flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. Natural birth, we understand. But he says, you need to be born again. A spiritual birth needs to take place. Now, I know about natural birth. I was there for all of our kids being born, except for a brief time I had to go to McDonald's for breakfast and almost missed the last one being born. But I learned about childbirth, but I learned on the farm about birth. I understand. This is born of water. I pulled a calf a number of times, or helped dad at least. I'm not good. I talk bigger about farming when I'm behind a pulpit than I actually can do out there. So if you put me, you know, in a cow and say, or with a cow and say, pull that calf, I might be a little bit stumped. But I've been there. I learned all about this stuff on the farm and pulling calves. One time pulling calf, and I had come back to help dad out, and I hadn't been around for a while and pulled it back. I wasn't ready for it, and calf came over on top of me, and I was filled with water and all sorts of other stuff. It was pretty gross. Some of you have been calving here recently. You know what I'm talking about. I thought I knew about it when it came time for our first child to be born. And we took this class called Lamaze class. And went in there and thought, good, all right. See how this compares. They showed us videos and stuff in the class. And like, and she's talking about breech babies and stuff like that. And breech, and, you know, with calving, you can stick your hand in there and move it around sometimes. Can you do that? And like, Mr. Seawards, this is not like calving. Like, well, do you pull them? Do you use those pullers on them? And like, Mr. Seaward, this is not like calving. This is different. But I found out there are some similarities, and they didn't really want me to compare it too much to calving. I understand that it is different, but there's some similarities. And when a baby is born, there's a lot of just fluid. And this is what it's talking about here, being born of the flesh, being born of the water. And I think Nicodemus understood that and says that you need to be born, obviously, natural birth. You get that part, but there's a second thing you don't understand, Nicodemus, and that's that you got to be born of the Spirit. The flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. There's something, Nicodemus, despite all of your background and all of the things you know and all of the things that you've learned and who you think you are, there's something that is mysterious and is the key to getting to heaven. And that's the thing, Nicodemus, that's burning in your heart and that has been burning in your heart all these years as you've watched, or these months perhaps, as you've watched him, watched Jesus perform these miracles and this simple peasant man being the one who is making bold claims, even to be God. He says, you gotta be born of the Spirit. And he takes it a step further, and he says to him, you must be born again, verse 7, and it says, the wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. The word Spirit here is the word wind, or the word air, pneuma. This is the same thing with pneumatic drills, you know, air drills. You can call those your spirit drills if you want. And it's Jesus using this. You have to be born of the Spirit. You have to be born of the Spirit. Well, how does that happen? You can't really control that. You're right, Nicodemus. It's not one of these things that you can program. It's not one of these things that you can recite from the Old Testament. Matter of fact, God's Spirit will blow, and you don't get to control it. All you know is that it's blowing. Been around a campfire, and suddenly it switches directions. You can't control it. Wished we could sometimes. I'd send it across for me into other people's faces. But you, all of a sudden the smoke is in your face, and you know the wind has shifted directions, and it's in your face. This is how the Spirit of God works. You don't get to control God's Spirit, but he moves. And suddenly it's like the smoke is in your face. It's like, whoa, something deeper is happening. What's going on? And for Nicodemus, it was, for all of his training and all of his good things and what he thought Jesus should be or could be and what it meant to be this good citizen, is like, there's something more here, and that's called being born again. And Nicodemus, you feel the Spirit blowing. Do you? Have you? Has there been a time when you've been struck by the fact that Jesus is more than just a good teacher, more than just going through the motions, more than just adding one thing to your life, more than just adding on church, more than just, you know, going through the motions, more than just trying to be a good person, more than just trying to stop doing certain things and stop lying or stop gossiping or stop drinking or stop smoking or stop, you know, all of the things that we try and stop do, thinking that none of those things are going to get us to heaven. You got to be born again. And the Spirit of God moves in Nicodemus, I think, and he has a choice to make. And the choice comes down, and I want to speak a little bit about this next part next week, but I want to bring you to the verse that we know so well. Here's what it means to be born again. For God so loved the world that whoever believes in him. So if the Spirit of God is moving and stirring in your heart, if that has ever happened in your life, then you need to believe in Jesus Christ. That's how you get to be born again. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting or eternal life. There's a lot packed into that verse, but there's one word you got to really hinge on. You believe in Jesus. Not just believe he's a good moral teacher, not just believe that he existed, but believe that Jesus Christ has come and paid the price for his sins. Next week, I want to talk about especially that part, because this in between, what we're not touching on today is, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, which was a picture of their sin, even so, Son of Man must be lifted up. They had to look upon that serpent and see their sin, and we all have to recognize that we need Jesus. It's not just about us believing certain things about him. It's about believing that Jesus died for my sin. Folks, that's what it means to be born again. You don't get to be a Christian by coming to church. That's like saying you get to be a truck by parking in a garage. It doesn't make it happen. You got to be born again. And it's not a super difficult thing. It's as simple as believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. For God so loved the world, he gave his one and only Son. Whoever believes in him, believe that he died for my sins, that I'm a sinner in need of a Savior, and he loves me. God loves me so much that he gave his Son for me. I want to, we're going to have communion, but I want to give an opportunity for some of you to tell when you were born again. Share with us. I was going to sing a song, or have the team sing a song, but I think we'll wait on that. And just give a few minutes. If some of you would like to say, we don't need a big long testimony. Just tell us, stand up where you are if you want to say, and just tell us, when were you born again? When did it happen for you? Maybe you were a little kid. I did. I was 5 years old. I don't remember the exact time. I remember many times asking Jesus in my heart, just to be sure, over and over again. But there's a time I remember, sort of vaguely, when I asked Jesus to be my Savior, and I believed in him. And I would say I was born again when I was about 5 years old. There's kids downstairs that are learning about Jesus every week, and they can understand the simple things about Jesus. It's not too difficult to grasp. You don't have to be a Pharisee and know the whole Old Testament to become a Christian. You just have to believe that Jesus died for you. And he is who he said he was. So, why don't some of you share? Let me just leave it open for a few minutes. Just stand up and tell us when you're born again. We do practice, and we haven't done this in the last year since I've been here. We do practice, and I think it's a very important thing, baptism. Baptism doesn't save you. I don't believe it does. Baptism is a declaration of a faith in Jesus Christ. So if you are interested in baptism and you want to follow the Lord, because the Bible commands us to be baptized, and if you want to do that, please talk to me. We would love to arrange that and help make that happen. But the most important thing is for you to come to a place where you really, kind of like Nicodemus, ask the serious questions. You know, like, how is this possible? What's the deal here? Who are you, Jesus? And if you don't know him as your Savior, be brave. Maybe you've never prayed before and just pray, God, I don't know about this whole business, but if you're real, show yourself real to me. Teach me about this Jesus. So and if you want to talk about it, there's nothing I'd love more than to talk about that. So we're going to get ready for communion here. Let's sing another song. Get the gang up here again. Communion is another time when we just remember what God has done for us, and we declare it. Until he comes, the scripture tells us we're supposed to declare it. Make known and remember that he died on the cross for our sins. And he is our Savior. Now, I don't know what your story might be. This is a great song. Love lifted me. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Let's stand together and sing that. I was sinking deep within, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now saved am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. All my heart to him I give, ever to him I'll cling. In his blessed presence live, ever his praises sing. Love so mighty and so true merits my own best song. Faithful, loving service to him belong. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Sins and danger look above, Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by his love out of the angry wave. He'll obey. He, your Savior, wants to be saved today. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Amen. Please be seated. Ask first. that if they'll pass
the elements, the bread and the cup, all kind of contained in one little handy package now.
You know, they'd meet together to begin with almost every day. Yeah, just go ahead and pass them out. Thank you. Almost every day. And they would practice this. They would meet together, and from house to house, in gladness and simplicity of heart, the scriptures say, and they would practice this love feast. They would share, and they had things in common. Things weren't so good for the Christians in those days. They had a hard time making ends meet. A lot of times, the land was confiscated from them. If you like, bank accounts frozen and all sorts of stuff going on for the Christians. And so if you wanted to survive, then you had to share with some other people around you. And so people would sell land, people that were able to hang on to it, and they would pool their resources so that people could survive. And one of the things that was, or the thing that was most important to them, seemed to be remembering that Jesus died for them. And they proclaimed this from house to house, and every time they met and got together. And they did it on a regular basis, to begin with, daily, but then they began to meet on a weekly basis on what was what became known as the Lord's Day, the day that he rose from the dead, on what we practice now as Sunday. And they would just do this same thing over and over again. And so much so that if you spent your life going to church, it's kind of, it's old hat for you, but it's easy to kind of not recognize what you're doing and just kind of go through the motions. And 1 Corinthians 11 actually warns us about not just going through the motions, but it says pay attention to what you're doing, examine yourself, and don't eat this in an unworthy manner, because it warns us in 1 Corinthians 11 that there were some that were eating in an unworthy manner, sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. And for that reason, some were sick and some even died. I haven't seen it happen nowadays the same. And I've often wondered about that. How come some of these things don't happen quite the same way they did in the New Testament? This is one of them, but I do take it seriously that we are to examine ourselves when we come before the Lord and we are remembering his body and his blood, which is given for us. So you've heard the testimony of some of the people around you, how they came to be born again. And I would just ask you to take a minute and just to quiet your heart before the Lord and just say, God, just examine me. Where am I at today? Just take a minute and think. And think about what Jesus has done for you. So let's just take a minute in quietness and just consider where we're at. Matter where we're at, we can come before him and we can pray a prayer like, God, I'm a sinner. I am unable to save myself or get my life right. I try and be a good person, but you're a holy God that is without any problem, any sin at all. So I know that I'll never measure up to what you require. But Jesus did. And I know that I've sinned. There have been times, Lord, when I've got angry, I've spoke things, I've said things, maybe even I've done things, God, that are wrong and really bad, or just wrong. And those are sins, and no amount of me doing good is going to make up for it. So I need someone to stand in my place and pay the price to be my substitute. And Jesus, you are that. I believe that you are that. I place my faith and trust in you, Jesus, to be my Savior. Come into my life. I submit my mind and my life to you. thank you that you died for me. If you pray a prayer like that, that's the prayer, that example of a prayer, what it means to become a Christian. And so there are a group of people that they would pray these, they had prayed this prayer at some point in their life, maybe when they're 6 years of old age, maybe when they're older. And they didn't want to lose sight of what life was all about and what should define their life more than anything else. And it was summed up in an action called being born again at a time in their life, but there was a moment when that being born again was paid for by Jesus going to the cross. And before he went to the cross, he was whipped, he was beaten, his face was not even recognizable. They put a beast, a crown of thorns on his head that cut him up, and it must have been awful, but he suffered for us. And so they remembered that, and they would pray, Heavenly Father, thank you for suffering for us. Thank you for suffering for me through Jesus Christ. And I remember now, I call to my mind that you not only suffered, but you did it for me. And so as I take this bread, Jesus, Heavenly Father, I proclaim that you are God in the flesh and you have suffered for me. Thank you. Amen. And so they would take the bread and they would remember it. Let's do that. Paul said, this bread is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And then after supper, in the same way, he took the cup and said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink in remembrance of me. This is a picture. I mean, it's red, like the blood of Christ. And it represents the fact that his body was not only beaten, but his blood was poured out. They stuck a spear in his side and water and blood came out. He really did die all the way for our sins. Heavenly Father, thank you for stepping into this world in the person of Jesus Christ and dying on the cross, and bleeding to the point of death for us. We remember that now. In Jesus' name. So we're going to keep doing this. We're going to keep remembering the fact that he died for us. It's our core message. It's about being born again. And we're going to keep doing this, the scripture says, until he comes. We proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So we're going to get the group back up. We're just making them go through the motions this morning here. Shall we gather at the river? There's coming a day when we will be in his presence. And the book of Revelation talks about a river. So this song is about that, and we're going to keep proclaiming the good news about what Jesus has done until that day comes and we're in his presence forevermore. So let's stand together and sing this as a quote.
Shall we gather at the river where brining angel feet have drawn, with its crystal tide forever flowing by the throne of God. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river, and gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. Ere we reach the shining river, weights every burden down. Grace our spirits will deliver and provide a robe and a crown. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God.
at the smiling of the river, mirror of the Savior's face. Saints whom death will never sever, lift their songs of saving grace. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. Soon we'll reach the shining river. Soon our pilgrimage will cease. Soon our happy hearts will quiver with the melody of peace. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God.
Heavenly Father, thank you for our time together this morning. Thank you for being here. You tell us that you inhabit the praises of your people, and so we've come to praise you, and we've done that. And we just are so overjoyed by the fact that, Lord, you've heard us. When we come and ask for anything in Jesus' name, we know that we have your ear. And so, Father, we do thank you that we're not just kind of wondering if God is reachable or if he's listening, but you were listening. You've told us to do these things. You told us to remember in communion through this bread and through this cup. And so we know you are here. We know that you want to work in our lives, and we know that you want to reach down and you want to have a relationship with us. And so, Father, we invite you to continue to do that. Even as we leave here and go to our homes and in our community, God, we know that you don't just dwell in buildings made with human hands. You come by your Holy Spirit and dwell in our lives. And so we know that you are going out with us. You're already there. Lord, I pray that we might open our homes and make them welcome places for you to be. So thank you for our time together. In Jesus' name, amen. Join us for downstairs for coffee and goodies.